Okay, so let's take a look at these. We have 5 and 7, so maybe just somewhere. Maybe choose one or the other, perhaps.
7.
Maybe they're not that similar. Let's see. I'm pretty similar. 7?
Do the most common.
Yes, 7. Good. Okay. Let's jump back here to this page. You can see the guidelines for doing a implicit differentiation are not that complicated. They don't take up that many lines. So we give it an implicit equation. First, differentiate both sides with respect to x. So that's what we're about to do, right? Meaning that we have to treat y like a function of x, which means when we come upon a y or take the derivative with respect to some other variable, x, we need to treat it like an inside function, right? And use the chain rule. Collect all like terms involving y prime. That's where those y primes come from, because you're using the chain rule on the left, and all other terms on the right. Of course, it doesn't have to be left and right like that. It could be whatever, no matter what side it's on. Factor out the y prime on the left side. Finally, divide both sides by the left-hand factor that does not contain y prime. That is exactly what we do every time. Doesn't mean it's an easy derivative to find. But the steps are the same. So you take the derivative of both sides with respect to x. Okay? And let's start on the right side. What's the derivative of x with respect to x?
1.
Here's a quick side question. What's the derivative of y with respect to y?
1.
Just
1.
If I'm trying to take the derivative of y and I'm taking it with respect to y, then it's like I'm taking the derivative of x with respect to x. The derivative of a variable with respect to itself is always 1.
What's x with respect to y?
Well, the derivative of x with respect to y would be dx dy. Okay. Okay, so you got the right side is 1. Here, let's deal with this guy. What's the derivative of y with respect to x?
Dy
dx. Or y prime. I like dy dx more. Now we have to take the derivative of this guy. We got a function of x here. We got another function of x, and they are being. So we need to use.
Product.
Okay. So this is u, and this is v. Okay. So you got to take the derivative.
3x squared.
3x squared
times
y
cubed.
Plus 3y squared.
3y squared
dy dx.
I'll put the dy dx just on the end here.
Okay.
And
x cubed.
All agree?
Yeah.
Okay. So, just like we read a second ago, we took the derivative with respect to x, collect all terms involving y prime on the left side and all other terms on the right. So here we have our y prime terms, our dy dx terms. So we'll have, we'll do this all at once. At the same time, I'm factoring out dy dx, and I'm moving this to the other side.
Y squared x cubed minus 1.
Say what?
3y
squared. Oh, 3y squared x cubed.
Minus 1.
Very good, minus 1. Then, the last thing.
4 minus 3 squared y cubed.
So we get 1 minus 3x squared y cubed over 3y squared x cubed minus 1. Leave it up there until I figure out what the next problem is. Choose between 10 and 11.
10.
All right. Sine x cosine y equals 1. sides with respect to x. If you want to know what I mean when I'm saying with respect to x all the time, one, at least one piece that you should hang on to is if I see y and I'm taking the derivative with respect to x, then y needs to be treated like it's part of a composition of functions, like it's an inside function and you can use the chain rule on it. So we have 2 sine x cosine y, so that's a function times another function. So again, we need to use the product rule. We could extend this over and include the 2 if we want to. I do that usually. Okay. So what's the derivative of 2 sine x?
2 cosine.
2 cosine x. And we multiply that by?
Cosine
y, right? U. V, or u prime v plus v prime u.
Yeah.
Plus
negative sine
y dy dx, right? I'll put the dy dx on the end of this term. So negative sine y dy dx times
2
sine x. I'll put a 2 and then the sine x there. Equals 0, I think I heard already. You just want to get this part itself.
So negative 2 cosine.
The first part to the other side.
This one? Or that one?
That
doesn't matter.
That
2
one.
Sine y sine x dy dx equals negative 2 cosine x cosine y.
We should have flipped them so they're both positive.
Yeah. We're going to make them positive now. And we're going to divide by negative 2 sine y sine x, negative 2 sine y sine x. So dy dx equals, well, it's going to be positive now. And it's going to, 2's are going to cancel.
Yeah.
Cosine x cosine y over sine x sine y. Say what? Oh, cotangent. Yes, cotangent x, cotangent y. Cosine over sine, cotangent. Leave that up for a sec. That was 10. And we move on. So find the derivative by implicit differentiation and evaluate the derivative at the given us 0.20. So we're going to find the derivative of the function and we're going to find the slope of that tangent line. Well, we got this side. We're going to take the derivative with respect to x. Y is the inside function. It's inside of x squared. So it's going to be
2y
dy dx. Need, yes, the quotient rule here. Low d high minus high d low square what's below. So dy dx, the change in y over the change in x, the slope of the tangent line is equal to 2x to the third plus 8x minus 2x to the third plus 8x over 2yx squared plus 4 squared. I think we simplify this a little bit. I guess 16x over 2yx squared plus 4 squared. And I guess we could cancel out a 2. We got 8x. So Desmos. Take a look at this graph. Okay. So help me remember, it was y squared equals
x squared minus 4.
X squared minus 4
divided by x raised to 4.
X squared
plus 4.
Okay, so if we go back here, the point 20. The point 20, there it is, right there, 20. Without paying attention? Even those people over there who are whispering to each other?
Sorry.
The point 20, what do you think the slope of the tangent line is?
It's vertical.
So it's vertical? What kind of slope is that?
Undefined.
Let's go back to our problem. Plug in 20. Here, I'm gonna get this. I'm just that fancy. Okay, so we got 8 times 2 over 0 times, well, that game over, right? 0 times, that's just gonna be 0, right? 2 squared plus 4. Squared. It doesn't matter what this is 0, this is 16 over 0.
So it's just
undefined. And when we get an undefined slope, we know that's a vertical line. It's got a, we got a vertical tangent there. Vertical tangent. Either they have it or they're liars. I say they have it. 29 or 30, which one should we do?
29.
Do you vote 29? Raise your hand. 1, 2.
Sure.
30.
30.
30. 1, 2.
Wait, I'm
worried.
You're not worried about it?
Yeah.
You sway him? You on your side? I just feel more passionate on 30. It was pretty much tied.
Yeah.
We had a late vote, then we had a swing vote.
Can we get some absentees?
We counted the absentees. It was still tied, so I had to go on passion alone. 0.22. And you can see the graph, it's right there. It's this thing called a cissoid? Whatever. It's like being a mathematician is being able to pronounce weird names. It's called a cissoid. So you can see the slope of that tangent line that goes through 2, 2 is going to be, well, not undefined. Not going to be 0. It's going to be, I don't know, 1 or bigger, probably bigger than 1. The thing to do now is to take the derivative. You know what I'm going to do before I take the derivative? I was thinking about distributing the y squared, but then every y term would have a dy dx and that's a factor back down anyway. So let's just go ahead. We'll use the product rule. And here's u, and here is v. So the derivative of u is negative 1 times y squared plus 2y dx. 3x squared. So we're all big boys and girls, right? So we'll just solve for this real quick. 3x squared plus y squared over.
Please excuse the interruption. Would the following students please report to the high school computer lab? Cody Fife, Carson Whitfield, Trevor Nye, AJ Rice, Max Bauer, Destiny Greer, Noah Colt, Kayla Amt, Chloe Arthur, Cammie Carpenter, Jacob Deshaw, Hunter Harrington, Hildy Hughesby, Daniel Cryer, Nate Miller, Autumn Round, and Megan St. Germain. Thank you.
12 plus 4, 16. We get 2 times 2 times 2, 8 times 2. I don't believe that slope is 2. It looks 2-ish. If you look at that graph that's in the book, it's right there.
Do you remember the book?
Well, I gave you one for free. So that was 30. Now 47. This and the second. That's y. 47 is x squared minus y squared. The derivative so many times implicitly, it should be pretty simple. 2x minus 2y dy dx, using the chain rule there, right? Multiply by the inside function, the derivative of the inside function, equals?
Zero.
Very good, zero. The first derivative is
negative
2, it's what? X over y?
It'll be negative 2x over
not 2y.
Negative 2x over negative 2y. X over y.
Yeah.
X over y. Yeah. Simple first derivative. How do you find the second derivative? Derivative of derivative is the second derivative. How do you find the third derivative? The derivative of the derivative of the derivative. Okay. So just keep taking derivatives. So we take the derivative of the derivative and we get the second derivative. Excuse me. What do we need to use to take the derivative here?
Quotient rule.
Okay, so low and high minus high. What's the d low?
Dy
dx. Over
dy
squared, yes. Square of what's below? Do we know what dy dx is?
No.
Yes, we do.
Yo.
It's x over y.
Yeah.
Y minus x. X times x over y squared. Maybe up here, y minus x squared over y squared. I'm going to multiply the numerator and denominator by 4, y. Writing y is hard to do. So I distribute here, I get y squared minus x squared over y to the third. That looks better. Okay, let's see if that's what the answer looks like. From the book, where's 47?
That's from 16 over y.
Negative 16 over y cubed. Oh, look at y squared minus x squared. Does that look familiar?
Cosine.
Oh, wow.
X squared minus y squared. Right? Factor out a negative, and I get x squared minus y squared. Right? Distribute, I get negative x squared, positive y squared. What's x squared minus y squared equal? 16. Now, do you have to simplify to negative 16? Isn't this true?
Yes.
Yes, it's true. It's as true as this is. What's going to happen? You'll just have more work. Because what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to plug a point in from the graph, right? The graph of this function, x squared minus y squared equals 16. So any point is going to make it so that any time you plug in that x and that y, you'll always just get negative 16. Right? Every time you do that, you're just going to do... Like you're gonna make more work for yourself every time you plug in some point to find the slope of the tangent line. So save some time. Plug in negative 16. Okay. Well, pretty well, isn't it? maybe one or two that we just really feel like cannot possibly apply what we learned to it. We have to watch someone else show us how it's done.
Well, I have a question.
You got a question about this? Yes.
What happened, like, in the second part?
The second part. This part?
Yeah.
So I brought it down. I multiplied x times x. I got x squared over y.
Like, from the first.
From here?
Yeah.
To here?
Yeah.
Oh. So 1 times y is y, minus x times dy dx. Dy dx is x over y. Over y squared. Good?
Yep.
Okay. Yes.
Is there a formula for, like, let's say, the third derivative or the second derivative, so you can just go straight from the, like, first equation to that derivative? Or do you have to go step by step through the derivatives?
It's all going to be different depending on what kind of functions you're taking the derivative of. So, like that dy dx. You're gonna replace a dy dx when you take the second derivative. And you'll do it again when you take the third derivative and so on. But where it winds up and how many times it appears is dependent on what function we're looking at. Okay, yeah, is there anyone in problem that just is like, it seems, I don't know, too hard? Let's just go ahead and do this last one. You got it? What?
24.
Okay, so we just speak it up. We're going to do 24. Good job. Some people like to just, like, on a rainy day, just curl up with a book
and read it.
Yeah.
Just take derivative implicitly. like I would curl up with a book. I hate books. There's so many words. All right, we got a composition of functions. We're going to use the chain rule. We're going to use the chain rule again because y is also an inside function. Here we go. 3 times x plus y. Okay, that's the derivative of the outside function, the inside function. What's the derivative of the inside function? What's the derivative of
1
plus
1?
No, you're too fast. Okay. Derivative of x cubed? 3y squared.
Dy
minus x. Oh, this one's interesting. Got dy dx is on either side. There's quite a bit of cleanup here. Pretty much a lot of cleanup to go through. I'm feeling like I've got to distribute this thing to the parentheses that contains a dy dx so that I can get that as a term in itself. I would just divide by this, except there's a dy dx over here too. Okay. Can you imagine the whining that my algebra students are giving me? I'm trying to solve for x. They're doing stuff like this.
I wish we were
solving. And then, you know what? You were those students whining about solving for x.
I think we whine.
It was more like full out tears.
We were bawling.
Actually, they're having a pretty good attitude about it. We found something that seems to work for them.
It can be. It always works for most kids.
No.
You know what I hate about
an analogy.
DYDX?
What?
The Y has a tail, so you have to draw the line so far down.
Why?
Oh, and you just cut it off.
Okay. So I guess we'll move this guy over here, and then we'll move this guy over here. So you got 3x plus y squared dy dx plus 3y, no, it's minus, excuse me, 3y squared dy dx equals 3x squared minus 3 times x plus y squared. X equals, no, not equals, times 3 times x plus y squared minus 3y squared. Well, it's 3x squared minus 3 times x plus y squared. Interesting. No, it's not that interesting. Okay, so I'll move down. Divide by all this junk. Dy dx equals that over that.
That's definitely cheating.
That was
okay. Do your homework on a computer. Send me the video. I'll accept it. All right, there we go. How's that sound? Is that good? Oh, we're supposed to find the slope, right? Okay, -1, 1. -1 for x, 1 for y. I remember that. 1 squared, 3, -1 plus 1. So that's 0, so I'll just forget about that. That's nice. 3 times -1 plus 1, that's also 0. Let's don't worry about that. 3 times 1 squared, so 3. Over -3, -1. What's the significance of this -1? Of
y with respect to x
doesn't have a slope. Lines have slopes.
Well,
that's x. Is the slope of the tangent line?
Yeah.
The tangent line of what? Of where? At -1, 1. At this point on this graph. So Desmos.
Please.
Okay, how does it go?
X plus y cubed.
Quantity x plus y cubed.
Yeah.
Hey, get out of here.
What?
Okay.
Equals x cubed plus y cubed.
Ah.
Do you have tickets or not?
Oh, it also gets the axes. Ooh, weird. So at -1, 1, right there. Why don't I get to put a point there? I don't know. Anyway, there's a point right there. I guess we could just put a point right there. At the point -1, 1, is it surprising we found -1?
No.
Apparently at every point on that slanted part, we get a slope of -1. Do you see that it also includes the y-axis and the x-axis? Everyone, are you paying attention? Do you see that it includes the y-axis and the x-axis as points that are valid in this equation?
Yeah.
You got the Desmos app.
Yeah. It doesn't work well with iOS 6. It keeps crashing on me when I try to change settings.
Well, then I wouldn't suggest it. Okay. What do you think? You're ready to show me you've learned this distance differentiation?
Sure.
Okay,
I'm ready to attempt.
Can I have your homework, please?
I'm ready to attempt to show you that.
Okay, that's good. All right, take the derivative of both sides with respect to x and isolate dy dx. 2x plus 6y squared dy dx equals 0. Careful, 0. And dy dx equals, subtract 2x from both sides, divide by 6y squared. So negative x over 3y squared. Or anything equivalent to negative x over 2y squared. Or 3y squared. Anything equivalent. So negative 2x over 6y squared, yes. Working our way slowly but steadily through each function, taking the derivative, unpacking it piece by piece, product rule if we need to, chain rule if we need to, treating y like an inside function, always multiplied by dy dx when we're at the end of that. Alright, so we get the cosine of 3 minus 6x times the derivative of the inside, so we just throw times negative 6 out there, plus the negative sine of y dy dx plus 15y squared dy dx equals 15x to the fourth. The answer we get is going to get messy and crazy looking, but it is going to be what dy dx is. At the same time, I'm going to move this over to the other side. I'm going to factor out dy dx. Y dx times negative sine of y plus 15y squared is going to be equal to 15x to the fourth plus 6 cosine of 3 minus 6x. Good so far? Divide by that. Dy dx equals this divided by this. You might be able to rewrite it slightly more simply than that, but it's not going to be all that much better. Last one. Y double prime, second derivative. All right, you got a function times a function. That's u, that's v. We're going to have to do u prime z plus v prime v. 2x y squared plus x squared times 2y dy dx. All right, that's the derivative of that product of functions, quote, or the product rule. Minus 2 equals
0.
Dy dx by itself. Dy dx equals, let's see, 2. Minus 2xy squared over 2x squared y.
And you can factor out those twos, right?
Sure.
Okay.
We get 1 minus xy squared over x squared y. That's dy dx, but we want the second derivative. So we take derivative with derivative, right? Y double prime is equal to the derivative of this. It's a quotient. We need the quotient rule. It's low. D high, that's 0, minus the derivative of this, which we're going to need to use the product rule on.
Yeah, that's correct. So then, 1 times y squared.
1 times y squared plus 2y x dy dx.
Yeah.
Ooh. Low d high, so then we need to move this over. We're gonna have room. If you ever run out of room, just move your stuff over the side like that. So low d high minus high. High d low, okay, so it's going to be 2xy plus x squared dy dx over x squared y squared. Now we just plug in our dy dx, where we see dy dx. X squared y times y squared plus 2yx times 1 minus xy squared over x squared y minus 1 minus xy squared times 2xy plus x squared times 1 minus xy squared over x squared y over x squared y squared.
Yeah, I'm close to it.
So if I get like up to the first derivative, right?
Ready? We're just gonna watch. There's a playlist. We're gonna watch all of them, and then we're gonna actually use a different video because it's much better. Here we go. All right. Was decent. Not very good.
Boom.
It's a good idea. Make the ripple by pulling the finger out of there. Okay. There's a few tries in one video. Patrick, yeah. That was a pretty good one. This one's mine. Okay, now. Oh, come on. I told it to start later. Anyway, let me turn on the sound.
Discovery.
Okay, so yeah, this is some high speed stuff. So we'll use our videos to get an idea of how fast this circle is growing, how fast its radius is changing. Okay, and then we'll apply, since all water is pretty much the same, probably all of these ripples are forming at the same rate, don't you think? It has to do with like the density of the water, the temperature, all that much stuff.
Displaced.
Yeah, it's got something to do with that, because we, you know,
what Bush sees is astonishing. Water doesn't do what we think it does. When you pour water into water, the last droplets do a very quick but amazing dance. It's invisible in human time, but we can see it here. Scientists call this phenomenon the coalescence cascade.
You take a drop of water and you place it on a water bath. You ask 1,000 people and 999 will say simply goes like this. It basically merges with the underlying bath.
Exactly half of the droplet disappears into the water underneath. The other half becomes a smaller droplet that shoots back into the air.
And then it dumps its contents again, and now a drop of a quarter of the size jumps up, and it keeps going. We've seen as many as 7 such events in a coalescence cascade.
The water droplet acts a lot like a bouncing ball, because the hydrogen and oxygen atoms have an especially strong bond.
So, I thought it would be interesting to see what actually happens when you put a drop into some water. Very interesting stuff. Okay. Why are we doing this? We're trying to learn about related rates, which can be a pretty tricky subject. Okay. So, I guess let's just watch this very nice footage of a ripple forming. It's all in slow motion and everything's right above it, so you can see the circle that's forming. See the drop. You can see that little drop coming up, kind of bouncing on the surface, like you saw before. Yeah. Alright. So, So we want to ask some questions about this circle. Now this circle is going to relate to lots of other situations where rates of change are related to other rates of change. Remember how I said we want to measure things about this circle? The circle is changing. We want to measure its radius at any given time. We want to be able to measure its circumference, or I guess we can calculate it based on the radius. We want to measure the area, that kind of thing. And then we ask questions about how fast are these things changing. Okay? So, let's bring it back. Let me get a pen. How fast the radius is changing? I guess here's the question I want to ask about the radius. Do you think it's a steady change the radius is going through?
No.
You think the how fast the radius is changing is changing?
Yes.
Yes.
Well. Let's investigate it, I guess. Let's go back to the beginning. Okay. And grab this guy, circle here. And then we'll move ahead. It's like 1 second in the video, which is a lot less time in real life. Holding space? Oh.
What?
Well, because space bar just on one.
Yeah, but I can't stop it any time that I want. Okay, so I think maybe if I press forward, that jumps a lot. What was that, 5 seconds?
Yeah,
maybe if you just double tap space.
Okay, we'll do that. Okay, double tap. Space. Here, I'll stay over here then. Alright. So here it is. A double tap afterward.
And this is after 1 second.
It's after some increment of time, let's say. Right? However long it takes me to double tap the spacebar twice. Oh. That's going down. Okay, looks like that part of it's kind of moved out to here. Not so great, but okay. There. See what I'm trying to drive home?
Yeah.
I'm trying my best to move forward at the same increment of time every time I trace a circle. Okay. But if we look at the radius. It looks like it's growing by the same amount every interval, right?
Yeah.
Between here and there, between here and there, between here and there, it's growing the same amount, it would seem. I don't know how much that is, but it seems like it's steady. Okay? Eventually it'll just kind of settle down and we just won't see the ripple anymore. But it seems like that circle is growing, its radius is growing at a constant rate, okay? What would we call the rate at which the radius is changing? I would call it like the velocity of the edge of the circle. But in terms of calculus, derivatives,
delta R.
Dt.
Forget that.
The change in radius with respect to the change in time, right? Is that agreeable?
Yeah.
Make sense? Change in radius, change in time. That's what any derivative is, the change in this thing versus the change in that thing. When I'm asking how fast is this, the edge of this thing moving out, it's moving out at a rate of dr dt. Okay? Now, we're saying dr dt, it seems to be some number. Could be 5, could be 6, could be 10, right? Maybe centimeters per second, or something like that. Maybe it's like 7 centimeters per second. And that doesn't change, or it doesn't seem to. It seems to be 7 centimeters per second all the time. Until the thing just kind of like settles down and becomes calm again. But here's the question. Here's the other thing we want to relate radius to. Area. Okay? All right. So, at time 1, the area is equal to something, right? Okay. At time 2, the area has stayed the same? No, it's changed. The area at time 2 was bigger than the area at time 1. It's changed some, right? By some centimeters squared per second, right? Let's say. Now, in the next time interval, it changes again, right? We agree that it changes again, right?
Yes.
It gets bigger again. Now, we said that the radius, we all agree that it's growing at a steady rate. What about the area? Is it growing by the same amount every time?
Yeah.
You think so?
No.
Yeah.
Well, think about it. Between here and there, and there, and there, and there, and there, like the linear distance is the same, right? The thickness of each ring is the same. But the radius of it, circumference of it, like it's bigger. Like this ring right here, this red one, and this green one, they're the same thickness. Right? Because the same time has passed, the radius is changing at a steady rate. So the same thickness, but the radius of it is bigger, of the green one is bigger. So this area is bigger than this area, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now the red, that's how much it grew after the initial time. Right? And the green, that's how much it grew after at the next time two. Or I guess that would be time 3. Is the area time 3 is bigger and bigger and bigger. And the rate at which it's growing is getting bigger. This is what I'm trying to get you to see. Does that make sense? It's changing. But would you say that it's changing at a rate of like 3 centimeters squared per second all the time? No, if it's changing at 3 centimeters squared a second here, then what would your guess be for how big, how fast it's changing here? 4, 6, 5, something more than 3 centimeters squared per second. So the actual rate that the area is changing is itself changing. Right? What would we call the change in area?
dA/dt.
Not constant. It's changing. Okay? So here's the thing I could say. How fast is the radius changing? Can you tell me that?
Sure.
By our assumption.
Yeah.
7 centimeters per second. Could I say at 1 second, how fast is the area changing?
7 centimeters.
Oh, area? No,
the
I don't
area.
Know.
Does this seem like a more difficult question to answer? Okay, I at least want you to see that. So how are we going to figure out how fast the area of the circle is changing at any given time? Okay, so we're probably going to involve some derivatives. Here, let's take a little picture of this stuff we just discussed. And we'll get out of here. See what we can figure out. Well, to start with, we need to write a function that we can take the derivative of and wind up with these things that we're interested in. How fast is the area changing? How fast is the radius changing? We need to write an equation that we can take the derivative of. Hold it over here.
Okay.
Now, this is the derivative of what?
The area.
If there is some function that gave me the area, that would be the derivative of it. With respect to? Respect to time. Not with respect to A, not with respect to R, respect to time. What's this the derivative of?
Radius.
The radius. Some radius. If there was a radius function out there, that would be the derivative of that function. Is there something that relates, remember related rates, is there something that relates area to radius?
Time.
Wait. Is there an equation that relates area to radius?
Yeah.
Yeah, what is it? Area equals pi r squared. Now this is for static, measurable things, areas. If you measure the radius at some time, then I can tell you the area. But can I tell you how fast the area is changing? Not with this function. What are we gonna do? We're gonna take the derivative of both sides with respect to time. Okay? Meaning that it's going to be like implicit differentiation, except for instead of with respect to x, which is actually a variable that's in the equation, it's going to be with respect to t, which is just another variable entirely. So now everything's an inside function. Everything needs a chain rule used on it when applicable. Okay. So we take the derivative of a with respect to t. What's that? It's just straight da dt. What's the derivative of pi r squared with respect to t?
2 pi r dr dt.
You're doing beautifully. Now can I know how fast the area is changing?
Yes.
If I know
right.
how fast it's changing, how fast the radius is changing, which in this case is a constant, that's going to be a pretty dependable thing about a related rate problem. They're going to give you some rate of something that's changing at a steady rate, okay? And then I need to know what the radius is. Which radius are you talking about, right? When the radius is 1, when the radius is 2, when the radius is 3, what is the radius? So what would be how fast would the area be changing if we have a dr dt of 7 centimeters per second at a radius of 5? You tell me. Got the equation. It's right there. And all the plugins. Which is about 200 what?
19. Well, closer to 220, I believe.
219.9 centimeters squared per second. Okay. Let me give you a general breakdown of a related rates problem. They're going to give you probably some kind of a shape, whether two-dimensional or three-dimensional. They're going to ask you, how fast is something changing? The volume, the area, the circumference. Can we do this for circumference?
Yeah.
Yes. We have an equation that relates circumference and radius, don't we? They're going to ask you, how fast is the volume changing? The circumference, the radius, the area, the height, the width, it's something. They're going to ask you how fast something is changing. The challenge here is writing an equation that you can take the derivative of that has that rate that you want to find. Okay. So let's take another example, something like a triangle. This. And I'm going to say that this triangle is made by like two points that are moving away from each other, at right angles. Let's say that. Okay. Let's say that this one is moving vertically at 2 centimeters per second. This one is moving to the right at 5 centimeters per second. Well, what's that changing about this triangle? What kind of attributes are changing about the triangle?
Area's
got to be changing. Perimeter's got to be changing. What's that? Of course, the base and the height are changing. The volume of the two-dimensional object is the area. The hypotenuse is changing.
Yeah.
You got all that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's say I am going to ask you to tell me how fast is the hypotenuse changing, and let's call this A and call this B, so we can use some names. When A is 10 and B is 4. I guess when A is 10 and B is 4. Grow slow at first, and then faster, and then faster, and faster, and faster. Okay. So here's what you have to do. You have to write an equation that relates the thing you want to see change to other things that you know something about the change. Right? I know about the change in A, and I know about the change in B. I know about the change in A, I know about the change in B. I want to know about the change in C, the hypotenuse. So I have to relate, I have to go back. I want to take the derivative to find the change, so I have to write the function that I'm going to take the derivative of. When I take the derivative, I'm going to have the change in hypotenuse, the change in A, the change in B. Is there a relationship between A, B, and C?
Yes.
A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Now, that's the hardest part, is writing the function that you're going to take the derivative of. Now you take the derivative of it, okay, with respect to?
Time.
Always with respect to time. So 2a da dt plus 2b db dt equals 2c dc dt. I know all these things? And where could I find all these things?
Yeah.
2 times, do I know what A is?
Yes.
Yes.
A is 10, I told you A is 10. Do I know how fast A is changing? 5 centimeters per second. Do I know what B is?
4.
Do I know how fast B is changing?
2 centimeters
per second. Do I know what C is?
Square root of 116.
What's
yes.
that?
Square root of 116.
Square root of 116, how'd you find that? 10 squared plus 4 squared equals C squared. Square root of what?
116.
Do I know what DCDT is?
No.
No, I don't. That's why I'm doing this, to find that. But if I take all this stuff and divide it by 2 times the square root of 116, that's what? That's how fast the radius is changing, or sorry, the radius, the hypotenuse is changing when this, as this vertical thing is changing, as this height is changing and this base is changing, at the instant that this reaches 4 centimeters and this reaches 10 centimeters, the hypotenuse is changing at a rate of what? Has anybody found it yet? Oh, 116 over 2 root 116?
Yeah.
Which is 5.25. Which is root 116 over 2, which is what? 5.385 what? Centimeters per second. That's how. That's the rate at which the hypotenuse would be changing. Centimeters per second.
Oh boy.
If somebody asks you, how fast is this thing changing? You're gonna need some more information. Well, can you tell me some stuff that is affecting that? Can you tell me about the base and the height of the triangle? Can you tell about the radius of the circle? Can you tell me about something in the situation? Okay, I'll give you some information about that. They're going to tell you how fast something in this scenario is changing. Probably the measurements of one of those things at some point in time. Okay. This is a really, like, we can make this a pretty popular problem. What's that?
Oh, just the one with like the troughs.
Oh.
That's like the water.
I think I have a video about those ones. So there's a ladder, let's say it's 24 feet tall. That's a really tall ladder. Okay, and let's say that this is not holding on so good. So it starts to fall. Let's make the scenario here. It's easier, it's moving, and it's falling at 2 feet per second. So it's falling at 2 feet per second. Now, the rate at which it's moving away from the house, do you think that's constant? No, if it's really, really almost vertical and it falls 2 feet per second, how much the foot of the ladder moves is not going to be that much. But if it's really close to being horizontal and this falls 2 feet this way, it's really going to kick the foot, you know, the bottom of the ladder out a lot faster, right? So, can you tell me how fast the bottom of the ladder is moving away from the house when, let's say, the ladder is 1 foot off the ground, right? When that part right there is 1 foot off the ground. What you need to do. Going to help you as much this time. You need to write a relationship between stuff that you know and stuff you want to know, right? What do you want to know? You want to know how fast this is changing. You want to know, okay, let's call this distance from here to there, from there to there, call it x, right? When I ask you how fast it's moving away from the house, what do you want to know in terms of calculus? Of? X with respect to?
Dx dt
is what I want to know. That means there's some function out there with x in it that I'm going to take the derivative of with respect to t, and I'll get a dx dt in there, right? I need to relate x to, I don't know, maybe we'll call it y, right? That's the vertical distance. Is there a relationship between x and y? The vertical and horizontal components of this 24-foot ladder?
X squared plus y squared equals 24.
There you go, that's the hardest part. X squared plus y squared equals 24. Don't fill anything in. If there are things that can change in this scenario, 24 can't change, it's a 24-foot ladder. But x can change and y can change. Do not fill anything in until you've taken the derivative.
24 squared.
Yes. So don't fill anything in until you take the derivative of that function. Because when you start plugging things in, you're saying this measurement at this specific time, that doesn't matter until I take the derivative. I need to take the derivative first.
Don't we have to know either y or x in order to solve this problem?
It's 1 foot off the ground.
Oh.
So 2x quickly, dx dt plus 2y dy dt equals... It equals what?
256.
Well, it
just equals zero.
Derivative of 256.
Oh, yeah.
Of something.
No, it's not even 256.
No, it's much, much bigger.
It's all
right. But it's still zero, right? It's a constant. So the derivative is zero. Okay, 2 times. Do I know what x is? Can I know what x is? Don't I know what y is? It's 1 foot off the ground. I know that's 1, and that's 24. I can find x, can't I? It's the square root of 24 squared minus 1, whatever that is, times dx dt, the thing I'm trying to find, plus 2 times, do I know what y is?
Yeah.
It's 1. Do I know what dy dt is? Do I know what dy dt is?
2 root 2 feet.
Negative.
Negative. Negative 2 feet, because it's getting smaller. What's the rate of change? It's making it get smaller, so it's negative. Equals 0, solve for dx dt. Okay. Hold on. I'm going to pass this out to you. Some sample AP questions.
Score.
Okay, I'll have to text you which problems that you can do. You can't do them all. Just the really great ones that you need. So with the text about the homework, I will send you which problems on here you can do. All right, see you later. Have a good day.
Do you have a print next period?
No.